Thank you very much. I learned to dress like a banker from Ralph Nader. Cy Hirsch does the same thing, so. It helps if you're white, so you come out with the imprimatur of the establishment to blow it up. I wrote a book before Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt, which some of you may have seen, which I did with the great cartoonist Joe Sacco. Yeah, he's incredible. And if you haven't seen Sacco's book, Footnotes in Gaza, you should read it. It is an incredible tour de force. He and I had been in Gaza writing a magazine piece for Harper's. We had lived in a refugee camp called Khan Yunis for 10 days and just wrote day by day what that experience was like for the Palestinians, including, of course, in the afternoon, witnessing Israeli soldiers taunting in Arabic. I speak Arabic, and one afternoon we were near the edge of the sand dunes where the Jewish settlement was, and we hear in Arabic, ta'al ta'al, which means come, come. And these kids are playing, 10, 11 years old, playing soccer with a rag ball in the sand. And my ears sort of went up because it was done over the loudspeaker of a Jeep. And the kids, you know, looked, and then we heard Arabic curse words, kasumak, which I won't tell you what it means, and kaub ibn kaub, on and on. And these little kids started throwing rocks. There was a cyclone fence that separated the Jeep from the rocks, the kids. The rocks could barely reach the Jeep, and it was an armored Jeep. And at a certain point, Israeli soldiers stepped out of that Jeep with M16s and shot these children. It was one of those moments as a journalist that is almost unbelievable. You can't quite comprehend what you're even seeing. And this happened on it usually happened after school on the same time. And the fact that these kids were being taunted, I've been in places like Sarajevo where children were shot by Serbian snipers, but I had never seen children taunted, enticed, and killed like mice in a trap for sport. And so we went to the hospital, so we had their names, the dates. We were there when the shooting took place. In several cases, I went to the funerals, and we wrote this up, and you can imagine the firestorm that created with the Israeli lobby in the United States, but it was kind of ironproof because we were there. We had all of the factual information that laid it out. And in the course of this story, we kept hearing about how in 1956, during the Israeli occupation of Gaza, in Khan Yunis as well as Rafah, Israeli soldiers, this was during the Suez Crisis. So in the Suez Crisis, Israel took it upon itself to occupy Gaza for 100 days. Ariel Sharon, Force 101, was in charge of it. How they had taken hundreds of young men of military age, corralled them actually in a school in Khan Yunis, and then executed them. And this was a story that, it's just one of those moments in Middle Eastern history that had been completely lost, certainly to the outside world. And I put that in the story, in the original Harper's piece, which was edited out in the wisdom of the editors because it was history. And Joe was so incensed that he went back and spent 6 years tracking down these survivors who had witnessed this event and pieced it together in this utterly magnificent work, Footnotes in Gaza, which is really one of the great works of the Palestine-Israel conflict. And I remember when he sent me the copy, I went off into a secluded corner and read it alone. And I of course was weeping by the end. So he's an amazing artist, an amazing journalist, And the reason I wanted to do Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt with Joe, we wrote that book out of the poorest pockets of the United States, Camden, New Jersey, which per capita is the poorest city in the United States, Pine Ridge, South Dakota, where the average life expectancy of a male is 48. That's the lowest in the Western Hemisphere outside of Haiti. At any one time on Pine Ridge, 60% of the occupants have neither electricity or running water. We wrote it out of the coal fields of southern West Virginia, the produce fields in Florida, where you are constantly uncovering slave operations, that is, undocumented workers from Honduras or Mexico or other countries held literally behind barbed wire and forced to work without pay. You'll hear periodically of officials uncovering oftentimes up to 100-200 workers being held like this. We ended with the Occupy movement. But one of the reasons I wanted to work with Joe in the book, aside from the fact that he's wonderful company, was because these people are invisible. And the level of poverty and despair that now afflicts, we're now closing in on 50% of this country, is virtually unseen on purpose. I mean, a corporate media that is, you know, in essence, blotted it out. But before I talk about the new book, I want to talk a little bit about a book that I wrote a few years ago. As kind of back, you know, one book kind of morphs into the next. And this was a book called Death of the Liberal Class, which started out for a big publishing house called Knopf. And Knopf had called me and asked me if I would be willing to write a critique of the American press. I mean, the irony, they called my agent. And the funny part about it is that the two previous people who they had asked to write the book, who had both declined, was the former editor of the New York Times and the former editor of the Washington Post. How I managed to be number three on the list is kind of mystifying, since the book they wrote and the book I wrote would bear nothing, no likeness at all. And it was also a very good lesson. Don't ever write a book if you're a writer that's somebody else's idea. So I wrote my Chomsky-esque critique of the American press and turned it in. You can imagine the editors at Knopf hated it and didn't quite know what to do, and then said that, okay, we'll publish it, but we're going to take out all the negativity. So that didn't go down particularly well. And I got Nation Books. You get half of your advance up front, and Nation Books doesn't have a lot of money. So I said, look, just give me the half. I mean, pay them back the half that they paid me, and you can have the whole book. And what happened in that transition was that I began to reflect on all of the pillars of the liberal establishment, because it's not just the press that's collapsed. It's labor, culture, which of course has been commercialized, the Democratic Party, the liberal church, which I come out of. My father was a minister. I'm a seminary graduate. And I wanted to ask why. Why did these liberal institutions that, as Karl Popper says, once made incremental and piecemeal reform possible, the kind of safety valve that exists within a capitalist democracy, what happened? And it led me back to the eve of World War I. A moment in history that's been pretty effectively erased from our consciousness. Because on the eve of World War I, you had powerful, radical groups that were rapidly transforming American society. You had socialist, large numbers of anarchists, I mean, even Yiddish anarchist newspapers, socialist groups, of course, the Wobblies, great socialist figures, Emma Goldman, publications like The Masses or Appeal to Reason, which had the fourth highest circulation in the United States, a socialist journal, which had kind of cornered the robber baron in the capitalist class. And at that moment, of course, there was really ever since the Civil War, a strong strain of anti-militarism, if you can believe it, in America, and a deep reluctance on the part of the American public to become involved in World War I. But of course, what happened is that as the war continued, the arms manufacturers in the United States began supplying munitions and weapons to the British and the French. And the British and the French had to take out tremendous loans, courtesy of Wall Street, in order to buy those munitions. And towards the end of the war, with the collapse of Tsarist Russia, you had this moment when the Kaiser was able to transfer 51 divisions from the Eastern Front to the Western Front. And the fear on the part of Wall Street was that if the British and French were defeated, they would never be repaid. So suddenly Wall Street began to lobby the Wilson administration. Wilson had run for re-election in 1916 on the slogan, "He kept us out of the war." So Wilson's lobbied. To be fair to Wilson, you also had Germany's decision to sink Allied shipping. So American merchant ships were being sunk. And this created a kind of national outrage. And yet, when the decision came within the Wilson White House to declare war, they realized that these powerful socialist Debs, remember, was a fierce opponent of entering the war. And Debs had polled 6% socialist, 6% of the American vote, 900,000 votes. And there's this debate. I went into the archives at Princeton University. I live in Princeton, and actually pulled out the transcripts of these debates. And so you had Wilson with Walter Lippmann, who I think is a very dark figure in American politics, a guy named Arthur Ballard, and others. And they're all debating with Wilson as to if they declare war, how are they going to effectively silence all of these radical groups that are against the war. And Wilson wants to immediately impose the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act in order to essentially declare martial law, to shut these people down by force. And Walter Lippmann argues that this is a mistake, that by employing the understanding of crowd psychology pioneered by figures like Le Bon, Trotter, Sigmund Freud, and others, they could create the first system of modern mass propaganda that would, in effect, seduce most of the country into supporting the war effort. And then you use the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act to decapitate those radical elements like Randolph Bourne, Jane Addams, Debs himself, who refuse to be sucked through that propaganda into the war effort. And if you look at Lippmann's book, which I think he published in 1922, Public Opinion, that's where Chomsky, when Chomsky and Herman write their book, Manufacturing Consent, that term, manufacturing consent, they take from Lippmann. And so we build the first system of modern mass propaganda, which uses the understanding that people are not moved by fact or reason, but by the skillful manipulation of emotion. And you get, it's the Committee for Public Information, it was known as the Creel Commission, was headed by a figure named George Creel, former muckraking journalist, ends his career in the 1950s working for Nixon and McCarthy in the McCarthy hearings. And so you get a news division that every day is pumping out pro-war stories. Every publication is by law forced to publish editorials that support the war. The masses won't accept it, they shut down, Appeal to Reason does accept it, and throughout the war publishes pro-war stories. But what's fascinating is how effective that propaganda, Hollywood, of course, signs on immediately. Not, you know, I mean, the American Sniper has a long tradition of, you know, Nazi-esque quality. So, in World War I, they're publishing producing films like, which are the, you know, the equivalent of American Sniper, called The Kaiser, The Butcher of Berlin, this kind of stuff. You have speakers going throughout the country, graphic artists. And when you read Randolph Bourne, who I admire immensely, or Jane Addams, who I admire immensely, part of their despair is not only how easily the masses are seduced into supporting the war effort, into this abstract ideal. So instead of running settlement houses and trying to better the lives of impoverished sweatshop workers on the Lower East Side, you are signing on for this Wilsonian crusade to make the world safe for democracy and the world to end all wars. And part of their despair is how easily the left itself has been seduced into the war effort. Jane Addams booed off of the stage in Carnegie Hall for denouncing the war. Randolph Bourne, of course, becoming a pariah. Debs, because he denounces the draft. I mean, they're just looking for a reason. In prison, goes to prison. And that became, I think, the seismic moment in American history. We had come out of the bloodiest labor wars in the industrialized world. Hundreds of American workers had been murdered. Thousands, tens of thousands had been blacklisted, wounded, driven from their jobs. This was unprecedented. We had, you know, a whole vigilante class of Pinkertons, gun thugs, Baldwin Felts. You especially can read about it in the Ludlow and Homestead and all the coal strikes. And at this point, the state or the capitalist class had found the mechanism by which they could destroy radical and populist movements. And so immediately after the war, and it's almost instantaneous, the dreaded Hun, which has been demonized throughout that period that America was at war, becomes the dreaded Red. And they tie it by claiming that Lenin got German money, which historically is actually accurate. He did get German money. But they tie it as if Lenin was a creation of the German war machine. And there's a writer that I like very much, who's not read much anymore, although he should be. His name is Dwight MacDonald. Dwight MacDonald, who was briefly a Trotskyite, but he was just unorthodox in everything he did. And there's a famous moment when Dwight MacDonald is writing for the Trotsky-esque journal in the 30s in New York, and Trotsky's reading it and having a fit, and finally writes a letter to all the Trotskyites in New York that says, every person has a right to their own stupidities, but Comrade MacDonald abuses the privilege. And he was thrown out. But Dwight MacDonald, he's also a beautiful writer, and he can write about culture, which is kind of rare, as presciently and thoughtfully as he can about politics. His beautiful essays on Joyce and literary essays. So he writes about this, the end of the war. And he said, I think, something very important, and that is that at the end of the war, mass propaganda and the state created for the first time what he calls the psychosis of permanent war. And he says all of the political theorists of the 19th century, including Marx, remember Marx actually hopes the Prussians win the war because it will further the workers' revolution. He said none of them confronted this disease of permanent war, where you are forever making war internally and externally. And of course, after the war, that's when you see the very heavy-handed use of the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act, that's when you have Berkman and Emma Goldman and a few hundred others deported from Russia. That's when you have the Palmer Raids, which leads to a lot of the deportations. That's when you have the closure of the masses and the closure of appeal to reason, even though appeal to reason had followed the rules during the war. That's when you have the destruction of the Wobblies, the anarcho-syndicalist union. There's a great story about the Wobblies, which you may know. They were having a dock strike in San Francisco, and so a bunch of Wobblies got on a boat, I don't know where, Portland or Seattle or something, went down to help. And immediately when they came down the gangway, all of the San Francisco cops were there beating the crap out of everybody walking and shouting at them, "Where are your leaders?" And all the Wobblies going, "We're all leaders." But so Joe Hill is killed in Utah, Big Bill Haywood, again on trumped up murder charges, has to flee and spends the last 10 years of his life quite very unhappily in Moscow. And we enter, I think, a new configuration in American history. But what's most interesting is that all of these propagandists, including Edward Bernays, who's the father of modern public relations, once the war is over, they go immediately from government to Madison Avenue and start working on behalf of corporations. And what's so fascinating, you know, going back and doing this research, is that people like Laswell or Bernays, when you read, like you read Bernays' book, Propaganda, which, by the way, was Goebbels' favorite book. Goebbels, and much of Bernays was Freud's nephew through marriage twice, however that worked, but he was twice his nephew. Anyway, and much of Bernays' family was killed in the Holocaust, but Goebbels studied the American system of mass propaganda and replicated it in Nazi Germany. And people like Bernays or Laswell, who wrote another part of the Creel Commission, they're completely upfront about the manipulation and how it works. That you have to instill consumption as a kind of inner compulsion, and that in order to do that, you have to overturn traditional values, self-effacement, because it's all about the cult of the self, thrift. All of that stuff is obliterated. And I think today when we talk about American values, such as they are, what we're really talking about are corporate values. Values that were imposed by corporations in order to make sure that we consumed at the level which would sustain corporate capitalism. So Chomsky, I just saw Noam a few weeks ago. And I told Noam, you know, if I'd been honest, I should have, in Death of Liberal Class, listed him as a co-author, because anybody who knows Chomsky knows that, you know, this critique of liberalism really comes out of Chomsky. You know, without question, America's greatest intellectual. But Chomsky describes the liberal establishment as a mechanism to ameliorate corporate capitalism, that it was never designed to be the political left. And the person who I think who gets this and lays it out most thoughtfully is Howard Zinn in The People's History of the United States. So Zinn, I have a great story about Zinn. So I teach in a prison. I can say this because I'm not New Jersey and I won't get back to him. I teach in a prison. I've been teaching in a prison for a long time. And I always teach something different because it's kind of more interesting. Like this semester, I'm teaching a course on conquest. So we just read Open Veins of Latin America. Then we're going to read Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee. And then we're going to read Black Jacobins by C.L.R. James. And then we're going to read Roll, Jordan, Roll, the great book on the world the slaves made by Genovese. And when you write a synopsis or, you know, of what you're going to teach, it's exactly the opposite of what you would write if you were teaching at a university where you're trying to entice undergraduates, we'll watch lots of movies and that kind of stuff, have class out on the lawn. And here you have to write it so it sounds absolutely banal. So I wrote, I wanted to teach a course on American history and the Constitution and the three branches of government, which all got approved by the prison administration, and then I bought all of my students the People's History of the United States. And I sadly never met Zinn, although I, of course, admire him immensely. But boy, I tell you, teach that book to African-American men in a prison, and you realized what a profound historian he was, because he told their stories, and they were stories that these men had never heard. And Zinn understood that the configuration of American democracy was one that was built to prevent popular democracy. Of course, at the inception of the United States, the majority of the people who lived here were disenfranchised Native Americans, African Americans, women, even white men without property. You had the Electoral College, which creates this utter distortion. Let's go back to 2000. It was not Ralph Nader who got us George Bush. This is an utter inanity invented by the Democratic Party, because Gore polled in the popular vote 500,000 more votes than George W. But because of the configuration of the Electoral College, and because they stopped the counting after two counties in Florida, and because the Supreme Court, like any good banana republic, overturned all legal precedent to support a president by fiat, we ended up with George W. But when Zinn writes, beginning from that period, he explains how all of the openings in American democracy were created by popular movements. The Liberty Party that fought slavery, the suffragists who fought for women's rights, the old Progressive Party, which Roosevelt, when he creates the New Deal, pulls from the Progressive Party and the radical unions like the CIO, who of course are pushing on him with the breakdown of capitalism, the civil rights movement, all of these movements which never achieved formal political power created the pressure to open the space within American democracy. And I would remember I'd be teaching this course, and Zinn is very cognizant throughout that book of the African-American experience. And I'd be giving my 90-minute talk on Zinn, and I would hear my students go, "Damn, we've been lied to." And what was so powerful and what makes me admire Zinn so much is how engaged that class became when they read a historian who told their story. And it wasn't a deification of the white male slaveholding class. I mean, read what Jefferson or Washington write about African Americans or Native Americans. And let's not forget, as Zinn points out, that by the time Washington was president, he was the wealthiest individual in the United States, because he knew that with victory in the Revolutionary War, the dividing line that the British had set up, giving lands to indigenous communities, would be broken, and he and land speculators seized that land and sold it at tremendous profit. So all of these movements were the movements that opened the space for American democracy. And the New Deal was kind of a classic example, as Chomsky points out, of how the liberal class is designed to work in a capitalist democracy. So when capitalism breaks down and you get public works, you get Social Security, you ameliorate the system to address enough of the grievances of the underclass to keep that underclass quiescent. And when they were restive, you know, MacArthur going in and using cavalry to attack the bonus marchers, veterans from World War I who were not being paid, Roosevelt's own breaking of strikes. I mean, Roosevelt is quite frank about it. Roosevelt says that his greatest achievement was that he saved capitalism. And that's right. That's what he did. But what happened is that with the destruction of those radical movements and populist movements, which culminated in the 1950s, and there's a really fine historian named Ellen Schrecker, who wrote two very good books on this. One is called No Ivory Tower, which is about the purging by the FBI of the universities. And the other is, I think it's called Not in Our Name. I forget the name of the other book, but it's The Wider Assault on Culture. And I didn't know until I read Ellen's books how, I mean, we know about, you know, Pete Seeger or Charlie Chaplin or the Hollywood directors and all these people who were blacklisted. But as Ellen explains, it was far more pervasive. So the FBI would show up at a high school and they would have a list of certain high school teachers never presenting any evidence that had to be removed because they were either communists or soft on communism. And not only would they be immediately removed, but they would be blacklisted. They couldn't get a job anywhere else. One of the unions that they went after was the Union for Social Workers, because it used to be that the Union of Social Workers organized and advocated on behalf of their clients. The first project of the New Deal that they broke, in fact, was the theater project. They actually broke it before the House Un-American Activities Committee was created, when it was still the Dyes Commission, because you suddenly had radical theater, theater that actually portrayed the reality that people were undergoing being disseminated all throughout the United States at government expense. I mean, they shut that down, I think, in 38. I mean, very quickly. Flanagan wrote a book about it called Arena. She was the head of it. And that's where, if any of you know James Baldwin, Baldwin's a 10, 11-year-old kid in Harlem as a white school teacher who takes him to see Orson Welles Macbeth, Black Macbeth in Harlem. And Orson Welles, being Orson Welles, decides that the three weird sisters all have to be witch doctors. And being Orson Welles, he said, we can't have people play witch doctors, we have to find real witch doctors. So he had three Haitian witch doctors playing the weird sisters. And go back and read Baldwin. It was an epiphany. It blew his world apart. It blew his world apart. And that's where you get Cradle Will Rock, where this wonderful satire of the ruling class. And when it's about to open, they surround the theater in New York City. This is Houseman with the National Guard. And Wells and Houseman try and get another theater, and they won't let them remove any of the costumes or props because they suddenly declare it government property. And so all of the theater audience walks through the streets to the other theater, and now they've been prohibited from performing the play. So Houseman gets up in front of the crowd and starts just to read, he's going to read the play, just going to read it. And the first character in the play, and it's quite moving because she wasn't a very well-known actress, she was vulnerable in that sense. Before Houseman can read it, she stands up and says her part. And the next character stands up and says their part. And they stand up, and essentially all of the actors in the midst of that audience recreate that play. When you read about it, people talk about it as one of the most moving experiences of theater. Theater was real. They created the living newspaper, so they would go around the country and act out stories of the day. All of that got shut down. Thousands upon thousands. I taught at the University of Toronto, and when I was up there, there was one of the great mathematicians of our time, his name was Chandler Davis, was hauled before the House Un-American Activity, and he wouldn't name names. And he was sent to federal prison, either for 6 or 8 months, I can't remember, and then, of course, couldn't get a job. And he spent his career teaching at the University of Toronto. So I went to found him. He was probably in his 80s then. He told me that he wrote one of his most important mathematical treatises while he was in federal prison, and he dedicated it to the Bureau of Federal Prisons, which clothed and housed me while I did my research on. But it decimated US culture. It decimated progressive and radical movements to the extent that I think we've even been robbed of the vocabulary to describe what's happening to us at this moment. And it, in essence, left us disempowered, which is what it was designed to do. And so then you began to see corporate capitalists carry out an evisceration of the country. So that by the 1970s, we shift, in the words of the Harvard historian Charles Mayer, from what he calls an empire of production to an empire of consumption, i.e., we are beginning to borrow to maintain both an empire and a level of consumption that we can no longer afford. You get the suppression of wages. I was just this morning, by the way, with Kashama Sawant, who's I have tremendous respect for, and has fought valiantly to raise minimum wage to $15 an hour, and is up for re-election, and has not only every member of the corporate oligarchy in Seattle gunning for her, but the corporate oligarchy nationally gunning for her, which is why she needs our support, because they can't allow this kind of movement, socialist movement, to succeed, even at the level of a city hall in Seattle. So the country, you lose any kind of check. Capitalism, corporate capitalism, becomes unregulated, unfettered. There's a wonderful book written in 1944 by an economist named Carl Polanyi called The Great Transformation. And it's a book about the nature of unfettered capitalism. Marx, of course, writes that unfettered, unregulated capitalism is a revolutionary force. And Polanyi picks up on this, that when there are no restraints on capital, not only does it have a self-annihilistic quality built into it, but it commodifies everything. So human beings are commodities. The natural world is a commodity that it exploits until exhaustion or collapse, which is why the environmental crisis is intimately twinned with the economic crisis. So 40% of the summer Arctic sea ice melts, and Shell Oil looks at it as a business opportunity where they can go up and drop $500 million drill bits to profit off of the death throes of the planet. And Polanyi, although he's an economist, actually uses the word sacred. He was, when a society loses the capacity for the sacred, when nothing has an intrinsic value and everything has a monetary value, then eventually all of those commodities are destroyed. And that is precisely where we're headed. And what that drive of unfettered, unregulated global capitalism, the rise of an oligarchic global elite, did was create this distortion of the faux liberal. Which was really first embodied in Bill Clinton. So Clinton, like Obama, or like Hillary, I mean, you know, the Clintons have decided they're not going to make the mistake they made in 2008 when Obama ran an insurgency. They're just going to be sure there's only one nominee now for the Democratic Party. The last 24 years of election cycles on the national level, in every single election, we have had either a Bush or a Clinton. I studied classics at Harvard, and it's like the end of the Roman Empire, where you have about three consul families that just trade power back and forth. So Clinton speaks in that traditional feel-your-pain language of liberalism, and yet assiduously serves corporate power. So he passes NAFTA in 1994, which was the greatest betrayal of the working class in this country since the 1948 Taft-Hartley Act. He passes the omnibus bill, crime bill, which sees the explosion of the prison population. By the time Clinton leaves office, you have 2 million prisoners. We now have 2.3 million, 25% of the world's incarcerated. We are 5% of the world's population. Almost all of them are people of color. the corporate state is feeding parasitically, whether it's through phone companies, private commissary companies, private prisons, guards, private guard companies, because if you're a poor person in post-industrial America on the streets, you're not worth much to the corporate state, but if they put you in a cage, you generate $40,000 or $50,000 a year. And that's the business of mass incarceration. And it's Clinton who began it. It's Clinton who deregulates the FCC. So you end up with the consolidation of roughly a half dozen corporations controlling what 90% of Americans either listen to or watch on the airwaves. And it shrinks the parameter of acceptable debate. Reminds me of what Dorothy Parker once said about Katharine Hepburn's emotional range as an actress. It goes from A to B. Well, it's sort of like, you know, so it's, should we just bomb ISIS in Syria, or should we bomb them and put boots on the ground? Like, that's the debate. That's kind of where we're at. It's Clinton that destroys welfare. And under the old welfare system, 70% of the recipients were children. And it's Clinton that rips down the firewalls between commercial and investment banks, destroying the 1933 Glass-Steagall Act, which precipitates not only the national financial crisis, but finally the global financial crisis. But Clinton understood that if he did corporate bidding, he would get corporate money, so that by the 90s, the Democratic Party has fundraising parity with the Republican Party. And when Obama actually runs in 2008, he gets more. And Obama has continued this trajectory. So there's complete continuity on all of the major structural issues from Clinton to Bush to Obama. Obama's assault on civil liberties, in fact, has been worse than Bush. The misinterpretation of the 2001 Authorization to Use Military Force Act as, in the eyes of the administration, giving them the right to assassinate American citizens, wholesale surveillance, and Section 1021 of the National Defense Authorization Act, and some of you may know I sued Obama in federal court. Now, this Section 1021, which overturns over 150 years of domestic law, permits the U.S. military to, in essence, carry out extraordinary rendition on American soil against U.S. citizens, strip them of due process, and hold them indefinitely in military facilities, including in our offshore penal colonies. The language of that section says that they can seize any citizen who substantially supports, now that's not a legal term, that's not material support, substantially supports the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, or something called associated forces, which again is a nebulous term. And to hold them in military facilities until, quote unquote, the end of hostilities, which in an age of permanent war is forever. So we sued Obama, and much to the surprise of just about everybody, including myself, case was called Hedges versus Obama. We won. And this created a real quandary for the government. Because using the military for domestic policing is patently unconstitutional, in the same way that wholesale surveillance of every American citizen is patently unconstitutional. And so the courts have essentially used judicial fiat to strip us of our constitutional rights. And the reaction of the Obama administration was fascinating. So Judge Catherine Forrest, who issued the ruling, issued a temporary injunction, meaning the law was invalid, was taken out of effect. And that was on a Friday. And her 112-page opinion, which is worth reading, I mean, she talks about how this, in essence, opens the door for criminalizing an entire class of people, and she brings up the internment of 100,000 Japanese Americans during World War II. So once that ruling and injunction is passed, the government sends not just the federal attorneys, but attorneys from the NSA, from the Pentagon, from national security to her chambers and demand that she put the law back into effect. And to her credit, she refuses. And so at 9 a.m. the next Monday morning, they appear at the appellate court, the Second Circuit, which is the next higher court right below the Supreme Court, and demand in the name of national security that the Second Circuit put the law back into effect until the appeal is heard. So the question that Carl Mayer and Bruce Affron, the two lawyers who brought the case and did all the work on it, and I had, and I was joined, by the way, after we initiated the case by other co-plaintiffs, including Noam Chomsky and Daniel Ellsberg and others. The question was, why did they react so aggressively? And I think the only assumption that we could come up with, or you know, I think was clear, was that they're already using the law. That there are most probably U.S. Pakistani, U.S. Afghani nationals being held in black sites. And if they could ever get out, and if they could get legal representation, and that injunction was in force, then the government would be in contempt of court. So what happened in the Second Circuit is kind of emblematic of what's been happening throughout the judicial system, whether it's with Citizens United or the FISA warrantless wiretaps and everything else, was the court, which has become a wholly owned subsidiary of the corporate state, had to find a legal mechanism to justify the stripping of our constitutional rights. And it was really only a question now of how they were going to do it. So I had also been a plaintiff before the Supreme Court in a case called Clapper versus Amnesty International. This was a case brought by myself and other journalists against wholesale surveillance before the Snowden revelations. And in the Supreme Court, the government attorneys got up and said, one, the idea that the government was spying us was, in their words, speculation. And secondly, they actually went on to say, and you know what, if they were being monitored, the government would tell them. Well, we now know from Snowden that it wasn't just us who were being spied on, but everyone, including everyone in this room. So the Second Circuit waited for that ruling. And they said, well, Hedges doesn't have standing in Clapper versus Amnesty International, therefore he doesn't have standing, means a right to bring the case, in Hedges versus Obama, and they threw it out. And the Supreme Court refused to take it. We filed a cert, a petition to the Supreme Court, and they refused to take it. This is all under Obama. It's Obama who's used Wilson's Espionage Act 8 times to shut down whistleblowers. The Espionage Act is the equivalent of the British Foreign Secrets Act. It is an act that was meant to prosecute those who gave vital government information to those who were deemed to be a hostile or an enemy power. It was never designed to shut down whistleblowers who gave information to the press about the malfeasance of government. And Obama has used that act so aggressively. And because the NSA is able to carry out wholesale surveillance, and I speak as a former investigative reporter for the New York Times, there is no investigative reporting now of the centers of power. It's impossible. Because anyone who attempts to leak or speak to a reporter is instantly traceable, which is why Snowden had to flee the country. So once you create a system by which the centers of power are no longer held accountable, once you have a court system that essentially uses judicial fiat to strip us of our most basic constitutional liberties, then you begin to descend into what the great political philosopher Sheldon Wolin calls inverted totalitarianism. And if you don't know Wolin's book, Democracy Incorporated, you should read it. Wolin, I just saw him, he's 92, is our greatest living political philosopher. He taught for many years at Berkeley, later at Princeton. He wrote that great, brilliant work in 1960 called Politics and Vision, which is the history of political systems in the West, you know, from the Greeks to the present. But Democracy Incorporated, he writes about what's happened to the American political system. And he describes it as inverted totalitarianism, by which he means it's not classical totalitarianism. It doesn't find its expression through a demagogue or a charismatic leader, but through the anonymity of the corporate state. That in a classical totalitarian regime, you have a reactionary or revolutionary force that overthrows a structure, replaces the iconography and language. In inverted totalitarianism, you have corporate forces that purport to pay fealty to electoral politics, the Constitution, American patriotism, but internally has seized all of the levers of power as to render the citizen impotent. And that system of inverted totalitarianism leaves behind the facade of a democratic system. It leaves behind the facade of electoral politics. It leaves, you know, or exists behind the this facade, exists behind the facade of a functioning judiciary or a functioning press. And as we devolve, as we confront the effects of climate change, as we face the inevitability of another global financial collapse. I don't know when, but Wall Street has not been tamed. They are once again engaging in that kind of speculation. Even writers like Gretchen Morgenson of the New York Times speak about this as inevitable. We are watching the state legally create mechanisms by which they can shut down dissent. I spent 20 years of my life as a reporter on the outer reaches of empire. And I watched how empire works in places like Iraq. I understand its violence. I understand its mechanisms for control. And what happens when empires break down, as ours is breaking down? And this goes back to Thucydides, when he's writing about the Athenian Empire, which Pericles, after he held it in check and then died and couldn't hold in check. And Thucydides writes that the tyranny Athens imposed on others, it finally imposed on itself. That what destroyed Athenian democracy was the Athenian elite. And what happens when empires crumble from within is that they take the mechanisms of control that they use on the outer reaches of empire and bring them back to the heart of empire. Militarized police forces. Wholesale surveillance, drones, the destruction of a legal system. I mean, I'm very aware, teaching in a prison, 94% of those who are in prison never go to trial. They're forced to plea out. And here's how they force, I'll give you an example from one of my students. Here's how they force them to plea out. One of my students was a was on the U.S. Army boxing team. He was the U.S. Army welterweight champion. He was on the boxing team for 5 years. When he left the Army, he started training to go pro as a light middleweight. And there was a murder in the city where his parents live, and he wasn't in the city when it happened. And the police cleaned up four drug dealers, drug addicts, excuse me, put him in a hotel, said, you know, you don't want to go off and go cold turkey in the county, then you're going to get up, and this is common in poor neighborhoods. So four people get up and just lie through their teeth. Before the trial happens, the prosecutor comes and says, we'll give you a 16-month plea deal. He says, I didn't do it, and I can't spend 16 months in a jail cell. It'll take me 2 years to come back as a boxer. So he goes to trial and they give him 30 years. Now the reason that happens, almost all the students I have in prison with the longest sentences are the ones who refuse to plea, which means most of them did not commit the crime. But then they all say, oh, because he was well known. They say, oh, remember, I'm not going to say his name, remember him? You want to take the plea? Or you want 30 years? That, because as Michelle Alexander has pointed out, if in fact everybody demanded to go to trial, the whole system would collapse. It's not meant, it can't sustain it. And now we're seeing plea deals where those who take pleas and serve sentences are forced to sign statements saying they will not appeal. They don't even have the right of appeal. I've got a kid in my class, he's not a kid anymore. I got a guy in my class who was arrested when he was 14 years old. He was in a gang, there was a knifing, a woman got killed. Now everybody else in the gang was 18, 19, 17, 20, he's 14. He weighed about 90 pounds. And the cops grab him, take him into the police station, won't allow any of his family in there, he's crying, and they keep saying, you gotta sign, you gotta sign, it's 2 a.m, sign, you can go home. He signs a confession. They throw him in the upper floor of the county, which is where all the people with the felony charges are. He's 14. He's there for 2 years, finally goes to trial. We forget how long people in jail sit before they go to trial. He's found guilty. He's not eligible to go before a parole board until he's 70. He has no money. He has no lawyer. He goes to me, you know, if I could just get a DNA test. He doesn't have money for a DNA test. And the system's built on that. And some of these people are so magnificent. He's one of them. Very bright. And my class, so I ended my class last semester. And he said, well, he said, I know that I'm going to probably die in prison. He's 39 now. He said, but I'm going to study really, really hard so one day I can be a teacher like you. I mean, I could spend the entire night telling you stories like this. And these people, once again, are invisible. And I think that it's incumbent upon us to look closely at what's happening within the prison system in this country, because it's a microcosm of what our corporate masters are planning for the rest of us.